Hey, welcome to CBiz Media. This is Irene. Thank you so much for being a part of the show. We want to say a big thanks to Lipstick Bosses and Michelle Alford. Thank you for submitting and sharing your video and commercial with us. Also, we want to thank our great contributors. We have Eddie Beret from California, who contributed a video. We have a couple other videos, one from Frankie B and Josiah Hunter right here in Detroit. So thank you guys for your contributions to our program. And you can always email us if you'd like to participate and be a part of the show. Email us at cbizmedia1@gmail.com. That's cbizmedia1@gmail.com. Thank you.
This is a picture of the prunes that are wrapped in bacon. Yes, Dad ate them all, and I forgot to do a picture. Thank you for the reminder to do a picture. These are the bacon wrapped prunes. They are delicious, and they still have their crunch, even after I put them in the refrigerator last night. Yes, try them, like them, yes.
I just want to remind you that you should always speak life on every situation. You should always keep Jesus Christ in every situation. Yeah. What do you do when you see God is looking down and he's smiling at you? I'm going to tell you what I do. I look up and I smile right back. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name, I say amen, amen. In Jesus' name, I say amen, amen. In Jesus' name, I say amen, amen. 6 a.m. and I'm up. Look, as I get up and I wake up, I lift my hands and I give praise. Another day, the good Lord made. And I'm just glad that I'm just sad. I can't forget to bear my cross. I could be dead, I could be lost. Instead, I stand, cause one man died, a righteous man that gave his life. I don't need games, I don't need guns, I don't need drugs, a late night club. I just need hope, I just need faith, I just need peace and Jesus' love. I don't need sex, I don't need pills, I don't need stress, I don't need fear. Deny my flesh, I must confess. And yes, I'm blessed to still be here. Yo. In Jesus' name I say amen, amen. In Jesus' name I say amen, amen. In Jesus' name I say amen, amen. 6 a.m. and I'm still up. Yeah. As I get up and I wake up, I lift my hands and I give praise. Another day the good Lord made, and I'm just glad that I can say, I can't forget to bear my cross. I could be dead, I could be lost. Instead I stand, cause one man died, a righteous man, he gave his life. Who said easy? This ain't easy. It's a reason I need help. Please believe me, God gon' keep, because I truly want to be kept. I don't need fame, I don't need fortune. See them things, I ain't important. Diamond rain with a big old chain, but the limelight life ain't really for me. I just need strength for all my sake. I give you thanks for what you do, for all you did, and all that's done. I will be done, I kingdom come. Jesus Christ, just keep my soul, hold me close, don't let me go. Hey, I give you my full permission and let your spirit take control.
Lord, I just thank you for allowing me to be able to do music to your name and allowing me to touch other lives of the ministry, God. I just knew that my life had to be different and that something was going to have to change. You know, I just keep living the way that I was living. And so you saw me where I was and you came and found me. You changed my life forever. So now, I'm going to make sure I do everything in your name.
Whatever I do for the Lord. I can't leave the house without grabbing my sword. I can't leave the house without checking my faith. Cause I know Satan trying to ruin my day. But I gotta be safe, I gotta be strong. I look to my Lord and I press on. Don't let the enemy ruin my job. You must be kidding me, we already won. So tell me what you living for. If you not out here living for Christ the King, the Creator, the one that gives the Holy Ghost, the one who is the Holy Ghost, the one that gave you life, the one who died at Calvary and don't just see his life. The one who love is infinite, who bought you at a price. So you should practice righteousness. To me, it's only right. I don't need pride, I don't need lust, I don't need lies, I just need love. I just need God, cause God is love. He's on my side when I give up. He's in my rhyme when I pull up. He's in my bed when I need sleep. He's by my side when it's just me. My spiritual life when I can't see. My spiritual extra food when I can't eat. He's at my job when I get stressed. He's my way out and all my tests. He's on my mind when I'm at my best. My God in life, my daily quest. He turned the sin into a saint. Daily stress when I was faint. Lord, I thank you for each day. You're my life, the truth, the way. I'm only here because of your grace. I pray one day to see your face. That I can walk up to the gate. You invite me to your place and tell me, son, your work is done. You once were lost, but now you found. You looked up when you were down. You passed that test.
Lord Jesus, we come to you today, giving you thanks and giving you praise in all that we do, Lord Jesus. Lord, sometimes we may be lost, but we thank you that we have always come back to you, Lord Jesus. Lord, when we go astray, we thank you that you have touched our hearts and our minds to come back and continue on with your journey, Lord, that you have meant for us, Lord Jesus. And I thank you. I thank you for all that you do for me, the wonderful God that you are to me. And I will continue to praise your name forever in your mighty name.
If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us for our He is just to forgive us our sins. So I forgave because it's in my heart to do it.
Right.
If it wasn't in my heart, I am not being the children of light. I'm not walking in the light.
That's
I'm walking
right.
within myself.
That's right.
Okay. The next scripture, verse 10, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us.
That's right.
Okay. What my sister has said, I'm going to lean on that.
All right.
That's it.
See, some people didn't understand why I was praising the Lord, because my friend Keith came. I haven't seen him in like 3 years.
Right.
It was a joy to me to see him.
Right. Right. He already gone.
And
that's all right.
Amen.
I looked up the word example. It means to illustrate or simplify. And
come on now.
God has helped me to be an example to younger people.
You okay?
He helped me to witness.
You okay? I'm zoomed in on.
Because what was in my heart was to be right in the right age to help someone know about Christ. We're not too old. We're not too young. We gotta get the too young out the way. You're the right age to help someone get saved. You're the right age. No matter what people say about you.
That's
right.
God is your time. That's right.
My next is Matthew. Chapter 18, verse 19. Again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. So, what I understood, or what God gave me the understanding of the scripture was, whoever you are in the crowd with, that's who you're going to act like, and that's what you're going to do.
Right.
Hang with Sister Big Mouth.
Oh, my God. That was the day.
Brother Messi. Uh-huh. Right.
So, that's why I look at some people when they call themselves saved. They want to be, they call themselves examples of Christ.
Right.
And there's hurting people right behind them when they first smile at you and come shake your hand like their friend, like your friend, and afterwards they put on the mask and come stab you right in the back.
Right.
That's not being an example
of
God.
No, it's not.
That's
This is hypocrite.
I'm going to find a word for you. Amen. You know, then I'm going to tell you.
But hypocrite.
That's not being an example of Christ. Being an example of Christ is actually, you actually meaning it. You actually meaning it from your heart.
Your heart. That's right.
And I'm finished.
All right.
And before I go, I want to say, thank God for how he took me through high school.
That's right.
And in high school, I had a problem with one. I had a problem with one of the boys in my school. It wasn't a serious problem. He came to me and asked me, he was like, "Well, Joe, I like your shoes and I like how you dress and stuff. You know, how do you get it? I was like, "Well, I worked for it and you know, I learned how to do it. So that's how I earned my So he was like, "Well, you know what?" He was like, "I can help you buy more. And you can have this materialistic things." He's like, "All you have to do is run with me." So I'm like, "Run with you? But he was like, what he meant was deliver drugs with him.
Right.
Different homes. So when he said that, I was like, "No, brother, I'm good." If you didn't catch that, I would be an example of Christ.
That's right.
I didn't hold the pressure.
No, right.
I didn't jump sides, jump shit, as they say. To please people, I didn't do that.
That's right.
I stayed myself.
Yeah.
I stayed holy with the Holy
Spirit. Yes, sir.
I did not know that he lived like two blocks down from me.
Yes. Fine.
So we was going to church one Sunday. He was riding down my street on his bike. He was like, "Oh, Joe." You know, I looked down, I was like, "Oh, God. Oh, God." He's not where I live.
Right, right.
So, but the next day,
right.
Everyone's in the hallway. I was coming down the hallway.
Yeah.
He came up the steps. And he was like, "Hey, Joe, I see you at church yesterday trying to make it into a joke."
Right.
And I looked at him and I said this. No, listen, it's everyone has stopped and they're looking. Joe, you talking about Joe going to church? That's what he do all the time. See, I can't understand when I come to church and saints can't forgive others.
Is Kanye West a Christian? Has he truly converted over to Christianity? And what should we think about his Sunday services? In this video, I'm going to share my thoughts on Kanye West coming up. Hey, my friend, welcome back to The Beat. My name is Alan Parr. Thank you so much for tuning in. If this is your first time here, it's a pleasure. If you want a free ebook, click the link in the description box below. If you enjoy this video, consider subscribing. Hit that little bell notification so you won't miss a beat. hip-hop rapper Kanye West has been going to different cities and hosting what people are calling pop-up church, or he's calling Sunday services, where he goes to these churches and a whole bunch of people are gathering around, and there's really not a whole lot of preaching going on, but it's mostly just singing and worship and music and people just basically getting together and celebrating God. Here is a short clip of these Sunday services.
You sent your only son, and you sent your only son to die for us, and all you ask is for radical obedience to you. Our Father Christ Jesus, thank you so much for bringing me to the home where I was born, where my mother met my daddy, and when my mother met my daddy. Thank you for saving me, for replenishing me, for delivering me.
Now, a lot of talk and speculation has been circulating around the internet, but in this video, I want to share with you how we can think biblically about what we're actually seeing happen in our culture. And the first thing that I want to consider is that we cannot judge whether Kanye West's conversion to Christianity is genuine or not. I want to take you to a passage of scripture, a parable that Jesus told in Matthew chapter 13. It's a familiar passage of scripture. It's the parable of the wheat and the tares, or the wheat and the weeds. But I want to explain it to you so that you really understand how this ties in to Kanye West's situation. It says here, "Here is another story Jesus told. The kingdom of heaven is like a farmer who planted good seed in his field, but that night as the workers slept, his enemy came and planted weeds among the wheat, then slipped away." And so the picture is as follows. You have this farm, and on this farm there are wheat, but then there's also some weeds that are also planted alongside of the wheat. And it says here, "When the crop began to grow and produce grain, the weeds also grew. The farmer's workers went to him and said, 'Sir, the field where you planted that good seed is full of weeds. Where did they come from?' 'An enemy has done this,' the farmer exclaimed. 'Should we pull out the weeds?' they asked. 'No,' he replied. 'You'll uproot the wheat if you do. Let both grow together until the harvest. Then I will tell the harvesters to sort out the weeds, tie them into bundles and burn them, and put the wheat in the barn.'" Now, I know I said a lot, but basically what Jesus is saying is this: when wheat and weeds are growing up next to each other, you really can't tell what's a wheat and what's a weed, because when they're at a certain level, they look the same. And so if you tear out all of the weeds, then you also may accidentally tear out some of the wheat, because you, he says in his parable, are not skilled enough to be able to see and notice the distinct difference between weeds and wheat. So in this parable, the man is instructing his harvesters to wait for some time, because over time, the wheat will continue to grow and the weeds will stop growing. And at that time, you'll be able to clearly distinguish what is wheat and what is weeds. And so essentially what God is saying to us through this parable is that it's not our place to be able to discern whether somebody is a wheat or somebody is a weed. It will be determined over time. Anybody can pop up on the scene like Kanye West and have some good services, or have a couple of months where they're on fire for Jesus. But the real test is not how they are in a few services, but what is their walk going to look like over time? So right now, it is not our place to try to determine whether this brother is genuine or not, because Jesus says over time, we will know them by their fruit, because a tree is known by the fruit that it bears. The second consideration that I want us to think about in terms of this Kanye West situation is, anyone who is on Team Jesus is for us and not against us. Now, let me explain what I mean here. In Philippians chapter 1, the context here is that the Apostle Paul is actually in prison for preaching the gospel. There, as an aside, there's actually four prison epistles. You can easily memorize them with the acronym PEPCI, P-E-P-C. So there is Philippians, Ephesians, Philemon, and Colossians. And so here in the book of Philippians, Paul is being being imprisoned. And notice what he says. And I want you to know, my dear brothers and sisters, that everything that has happened to me here has helped to spread the good news. And so he says, hey, even though I'm in prison, I can rejoice because my imprisonment has actually resulted in the gospel being spread even more. How so? He explains here, for everyone here, including the whole palace guard, knows that I am in chains because of Christ. He says, hey, I'm spreading the gospel even here in prison. I could be sulking, I could be complaining and disgusted because of where I'm at, but instead I'm taking an opportunity, even in prison, to share my faith with the palace guard. And he says here, and because of my imprisonment, most of the believers here have gained confidence and boldly speak God's message without fear. It's true that some are preaching out of jealousy and rivalry. So let me explain what's happening. There were many itinerant ministers at this time that were very, very jealous of Paul, his attention, his anointing, and his apostleship, and the miracles and signs and wonders that he was experiencing. But many of them, because they were jealous, saw Paul's imprisonment as an opportunity to get their name out there. And so they started preaching, thinking that they would make Paul jealous because Paul was not able to preach because he was hindered to preach from being in prison. They thought that they would add more misery to Paul by going out and preaching when they knew Paul could not be out there doing the very thing that God had called him to do. And notice it says here, but others preach out about Christ with pure motives. They preach because they love me, for they know I have been appointed to defend the good news. Those others, his haters, do not have pure motives as they preach about Christ. They preach with selfish ambition, not sincerely intending to make my chains more painful for me. So Paul says, look, I know that there's some people out there that are preaching with impure motives, and there's some that are preaching with pure motives. But now watch this very, very carefully. It says here in verse 18, but that doesn't matter whether their motives are false or genuine. The message about Christ is being preached either way. So I will rejoice and I will continue to rejoice. What Paul is saying is this. I don't care what these people's motives are, whether they're pure, whether they're impure, whether they're preaching to try to make me jealous or what have you. If they are mentioning the name of Christ and they are preaching the gospel and people are being saved and people are coming to a saving faith and a knowledge and a relationship with Jesus Christ, I don't care what their motives are. I am just rejoicing and thankful that the gospel is being preached. So my friend, listen, we don't know what Kanye West's motives are, and it's not our place to determine or to try to figure out what those motives are. But if he is mentioning the name Jesus, if he is inviting people to come together on Sunday morning and worship our Father who is in heaven, if he's pointing people to the one true God, then we do not need to bother ourselves with what his motives are. We ought to be doing like Paul and celebrate, and we need to be praying that God will continue to work in this man's life and celebrate what he is doing. Now, with that being said, the third and final thing that I want to point out is this. Be careful who you take counsel from. I want you to notice here, 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 6 says, a church leader must not be a new believer because he might become proud and the devil would cause him to fall. Listen, just because Kanye West is a popular celebrity does not mean that his popularity and his knowledge of hip hop music transfers directly into the spiritual realm. We must always remember that when we see him on the stage, he may be a celebrity in hip hop, but he is still a baby Christian. He's still figuring things out. And as a result, everything that comes out of his mouth and everything that he tweets and every post that he puts on Facebook and Instagram and all social media, we must understand that this is coming from someone who is a baby Christian who really should not be leading other people at this time. But we have to remember that since he is, we have to give him the room to grow in the same way that people gave us the room to grow whenever we were baby Christians ourselves.
Get someone to help you.
Just call on Jesus.
Ooh, he'll make a way.
Just have the faith, trust, believe, and call on his name.
I'll be there.
Somebody be encouraged today.
Call my name.
Oh, yeah.
Just call
me. your best friends, they were nowhere to be found.